everybody. Welcome to episode number 210 of the SoxProspects.com podcast. We are the web's number one source for information on the Boston Red Sox farm system from top to bottom, from Fort Myers to Worcester, up the Pike to Fenway, and all stops in between. Thank you for listening. My name is Chris Hatfield. I am the executive editor of SoxProspects.com, and I'm joined, as always, by our director of scouting, who did not get to go to a brand new ballpark this past week, Ian Kundle. Ian, it is Monday. That means no minor league games, but hopefully that starts to mean we're recording a podcast.
Yeah, I unfortunately could not go. I was had some stuff going on, but I'll be back soon. And thankfully, you were able to get to some games.
So
that will be that'll be fun to talk about a little later.
I was. Got to one game out in Fredericksburg's new park. New in the sense that it was made in time for the 2020 season, but that didn't happen. And it's actually kind of funny when you're driving in. They have a big billboard that you see that it's like, Fredericksburg Nationals, inaugural season 2020. And you just see it, and you're just like, oh, womp womp, it didn't happen. And they didn't bother changing the billboard. But
I can't blame them. They probably don't have, I mean, those teams run on shoestring budgets.
Right,
so.
Right. Yeah, I mean, it is what it is. It was a new ballpark. We'll talk a little bit more about what I saw out there on this episode of the podcast, as well as, injuries hitting the farm system pretty hard, especially the top 20. We'll talk a little bit more about that. The Olympic qualifier, the guys who aren't hurt, who the Red Sox are going to be without for a couple of weeks. What's going on with the 40-man roster? And as always, your emails. As always, we want to talk about what you want to hear about. So make sure you're emailing us at podcast@soxprospects.com. Thoughts, comments, questions, anything, send them in. We'll try and talk about them on the pod. So make sure you get those in. And of course, you can always support the podcast at patreon.com/soxprospects. And as always, we want to shout out our $5 level Patreon supporters. That would be Kyle Costigan, Tyler Woodrall, Jeff Traynor, David Nardone, Tim Harding, Bill Stanton, Deb Kendall, Evan Kirkwood, Hurricanes 1, Chris Fox, James O'Hara, Nathan Kenyon, Andrew Wallen, David B., Ben Burnett, Al Mendel, Kevin Catrides, Ben NRI, Paul Denyer, Lendl Martin, Cassandra Bukta, James P. McMahon, Stephen Gregory, James Bailey, Andreas Goldstrand, Corey Perrick, Forrest Perkins, Mark Herman, Aaron Mehta, Jeff Harwood, Jimmy Mountain, Brian Cowan, Dusty G., and our newest $5 level Patreon supporter, Pavel. Thank you, sir. Thank you to all of our Patreon supporters at any level. You guys are what allows us to do this. And as always, we should mention, if you are a Patreon supporter, you get access to other perks such as the Patreon game updates. If you're a Patreon supporter, on Saturday night, you had access to a report that I filed from Fredericksburg with what I saw, who I saw there. I'm going to get to some of that here, but not all of it. We have time constraints, so make sure you check that out to get the full report from Fredericksburg. Yeah, nice new park. Saw some good baseball. Got there a little late because of traffic, but definitely saw some interesting things there. Some guys that we hadn't seen yet on the site. I have a lot of we've got some scouting report updates we got to get to, Ian. So that's a nice problem to have at this time of year. But we've got those, your emails. We're going to play check-in levels again as well. We're going to call it check-in levels now just because, well, we feel like it. So, at any rate, Ian, where do we want to start? Probably get the bad news out of the way first with all the injuries, I think.
Yeah, we might as well.
All right. Well, we were talking about this earlier, Ian, and to me, a big part of why the Red Sox are in first place right now is that they have been able to stay so relatively healthy compared to the rest of baseball. They've had, what, Kike Hernandez and Christian Arroyo had very brief stints on the IL. They had Franchi Cordero getting the COVID DL stint, IL stint, whatever it is, before the year started, but he wound up getting healthy in time for opening day. Other than that, they've basically been healthy. Hunter Renfro was down for a weekend.
Yeah, Verdugo's had a few like things here and there.
Yeah, his back, right?
They've
right.
had hamstring now,
hamstring.
I think. And then
right.
The other thing is just like random people going on the list for side effects for the COVID vaccine, like Garrett Whitlock.
I don't even count.
Yeah, Pavetta. Like Pavetta, they didn't even meet a game. Yeah.
Yeah. Meanwhile, in the minors, though, just taking our current SP60 rankings. From the top, the first four prospects are healthy. Your number five prospect is Tanner Houck, who has not pitched since May the 9th, or not even not pitched, who went on the IL on May the 9th. He's made one start during the minor league regular season. At number 7, Connor Siebold has not pitched yet this season because of right elbow inflammation. I should mention Tanner Houck has a sore flexor muscle. Since our last podcast, Thaddeus Ward went on the IL with a right forearm strain on May the 19th, which you try not to read too much into. Forearm strain makes me nervous.
Very, very nervous. We were kind of like talking about it earlier in terms of the plethora of arm injury labels. I would say anything that's a strain and has to do with the forearm is number one on the list of like the pre-surgery injuries that concern me.
For sure.
And I think the second most concerning one is the one you'll talk about in a bit with Eduard Pizzardo, I'm guessing.
Well, yeah, we'll get there because 11 is Brian Mata, who underwent Tommy John surgery in April.
And his is an example. His started as a forearm strain, if I remember correctly.
No,
and
then, no. Well, did it? Because they said he had the partial, the like small but
it
tear.
Was, I think it initially was a forearm strain, then it was quickly changed to tear.
Yeah. Which
because a strain technically is a tear. So that's like what's confusing about the situation.
No, I thought
like
a sprain was a tear.
No, a strain is a tear, I thought. Is it? I don't know. Maybe I'm wrong. I'm not a doctor.
Okay.
Let me look.
But anyways, you go further down. The number 18 prospect, Connor Wong, hasn't played since suffering a hamstring injury at the home opener on May the 11th. And now Eduard Pizzardo went on the IL since our last episode with a right lat strain that he suffered during a game that looked worse, frankly. It looked like he was pointing at his tricep. When he basically threw a pitch that wasn't even close to the plate and the trainer immediately came out, it looked awful.
We threw like two to the backstop.
Yeah, it was two of them. Yeah. Okay, I thought it was two. Yeah. I couldn't remember.
Yeah.
So, yeah, that happens. That looks awful. So that's 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 members of the top 20. Either on the IL or just not playing right now.
Not great.
Looking at elsewhere in the system, I mean, there are some other injuries. Devlin Granberg hasn't played in a few days. Nick Decker, our number 25 prospects, looks like he might be dinged up. Hudson Potts, the number 21 prospect, hasn't played yet because he's rehabbing his oblique injury in Fort Myers.
Connor Wong still hasn't played since opening day.
I said that while you
were
looking.
Sorry, I missed that one.
No, it's fine. Brock Bell, the number 58 prospect in the system, hasn't pitched this year. He's on the 60-day IL for reasons we don't know.
Zach Schellinger
went on the IL recently. Some of this happens, right?
I think that the pitcher injuries they had to have seen this coming. Because like after the year off, ramping up to game speed, there's just no way to simulate how taxing it is to pitch in a professional game versus even in like, you know, scrimmages or whatever guys were doing last year. So
yeah,
I think just the number of, you know, pitcher injuries is unfortunately just a product of the circumstance of the last couple of years with COVID.
Yeah. I mean, that's probably true. Yeah. Murphy Andrew was deactivated at some point and it's not being reflected on Salem's MILB roster because they don't have a media guy. Yeah, it's a bit of a problem right now. That said, I really don't know what you can do about it other than just bite the bullet and try and ride it out. They're certainly not trying to get their guys hurt. Look at what they're doing in Salem, for example, they've got those guys on tight pitch counts.
I like it, though.
Yeah, they're throwing like three-inning outings.
Isn't the only one who's not is Aldo Ramirez, which makes sense. Cause
Aldo and Drohan's going four.
Okay, Aldo makes sense because he threw like a full season in 2019, basically.
Yeah, Aldo Ramirez is throw. I put this in the forum the other day. Let me see if I can track it down.
And I do wonder though. Part of it could be like success. Like Drohan's just been excellent this year.
Well, that's why I say it's start. I was able to look at everybody's first three starts, and if you look at it. Let me try. I'm trying to pull it up. My computer runs at a snail's pace while I've got Skype open, and I probably post too much to be able to find it quickly. But yeah, I saw Jeremy Wu Yelland. He's throwing three inning stints. Drohan's going four. I want to say Zephyr John is throwing four.
Zephyr John's been going three every outing because I've been doing those Twitter updates. Yes. And Yeah, he's been doing three. Yeah. He pitched yesterday, I believe. Wait, did you didn't go Sunday, right?
I went Saturday.
Saturday, yeah. He threw Sunday, he threw three innings. Because I did a thing on it this morning.
My phone's gonna die while we're on this podcast. Where's this?
Yeah, post? Zapper John's thrown 12.1 innings in four games.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
So 3-3, 2.1, and 4. So he had 1-4 inning, which was his only good start. Was his best start. He was actually decent yesterday, but...
Yeah, but anyways, what they're doing, while I look for the exact numbers, is they're basically doing, like, not piggyback starters, but long relievers behind everyone. Zephyr John. So, like, Jordan DiValerio is going 3 innings in relief every time. Casey Cobb is going 3 innings. Aaron Perry was going 3 innings. Jorge Rodriguez is going every 3 innings. Yeah, here we go. So it looks like they've got roughly Aldo Ramirez is probably doing 4 innings or 80 pitches. Jeremy Wu Yellen, 3 innings or 60 pitches. Ryan Zephyrjohn, 4 innings or 70 pitches. Bradley Blaylock, 3 innings or maybe 60 or so pitches. And then Drohan's doing like 70 pitches or so, like, you know, probably 4 innings or five. I think he went 5 his second start, so that's why I didn't really know how to put that, because I think he was the first guy to go more than 4 innings. But it's very interesting. So meanwhile, they've got all those other guys going in long relief. And it's when you've got a 30-man roster, you can do that because you still have like a 6-man regular bullpen. So it's
exactly.
It's kind of a, you know, it's an inspired sort of decision by the Red Sox as a way to, you know, keep guys' arm fresh. You know, in Portland, even, you had long relievers in Denny Reyes, and Manuel De Jesus and Matt Kent. All those guys are throwing like 2-3-4 innings in relief. You know, Kent, I think, went like 3 1/3, 4 4 in relief, and he's probably going to get starts these next couple weeks with Manuel De Jesus gone. So
isn't Greenville really the only team that isn't doing that?
Well, so they've got Yusniel Padron Artiles piggybacking.
Yeah, but like Van Jacob Bell. Wallace is like a 1 or 2 inning reliever. Scherf is a 1 or 2 inning reliever. Bryant's a 1 or 2 inning guy.
Exactly. They're the like other than Padron Artiles.
It's all 1 or 2 inning relievers.
But again, they've got 29 or 30 active guys, so they can just do it with numbers. You know, if you've got guys going 2 innings, then you got 2 guys who go 2.
It is a little interesting. I just think that's kind of like how the levels evened out, that they really don't have any like guys who started in the past. In terms of guys who they have guys who started in this past, but what I meant is like guys who you would think would fill that piggyback role other than Padron Artiles versus, like, mm-hmm. as you said, you know, you listed like 3 guys for Portland. Salem has a full 5-guy rotation of it.
Yeah,
like
basically.
Pawtucket has a few guys. Well, did until the injuries, had several Worcester. Guys who would fit that mold too. So
Worcester.
Yeah, I think that's just kind of how it fell, but yeah, it's interesting.
Yeah. Yeah. It's been strange. Go ahead.
I was just going to say, just kind of transitioning, should we talk about the impact this injury thing has on the Red Sox?
Yeah. I mean, so if you look at and that's a good transition, because I tweeted about this the other day, that the 40-man roster, because what I realized is I was looking at, you know, when they had Hernandez get hurt and they had Arroyo get hurt and they had guys going on IL. There really doesn't seem to be a lot of usable 40-man depth, in the sense that you've got Michael Chavis, who can come up and who got optioned back today.
Yeah.
Jonathan Araúz.
Who's been up.
Has been up, but he clearly comes up to be a bench player. Yeah. Right?
Well, Danny Santana was added.
Well, Danny Santana. Oh, that was the other thing, is they had Danny Santana coming back. He got added last week. That's true.
Yeah, Friday. They DFA'd Austin Bryce as the counter move, which was not surprising. At all. Thankfully, finally, our 3-man bench nightmare is over.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
Took long enough, but yeah.
But when you look at it, you've got those two guys on the offensive side. And then on the pitching side, you had Colton Brewer and Edward Bizzardo, who's now injured.
And yeah, just like, there's been no update on him. Like, so.
Well, he went on IL. No, there has been. They said he's going to be down at least 3 weeks.
Oh, okay. Well, I missed the 3 weeks.
That was today. Yeah, that was today. Cora said that. Maybe yesterday. But he said at least 3 weeks. But at any rate, you look at it and how you're like, it's a 40-man roster with a 26-man active roster. How are there so few usable players?
Yeah.
And the problem is that you look at it, and if you look at the 40 outside of Fenway, it's Hauk on the IL, Seabold on the IL, now Bizzardo on the IL.
Yeah.
Connor Wong is hurt. Not on the IL, but he's hurt. Okay? So you've got those guys injured. You look further on the 40, man. You've got Marcus Wilson, not really a major league call-up guy yet at this point. He's in AAA, so he's closer than a couple of the other guys, but like, I don't think they would call him up to play him, especially because they've got so much flexibility on the major league roster.
No, definitely not.
No matter who gets hurt, Chavis is the first guy up.
Yeah, and right? he could play left field if they had to.
But, I mean, well, they haven't put him out there.
Well, they don't need to, though, I guess, because, like, Marwin Gonzalez plays left field, Cordero Franchi plays left field, and Danny Santana looks like he's going to be the everyday somewhere player. Yeah. So.
And Kike Hernandez has been playing mostly center field this year.
Yeah.
JD Martinez has played a fair amount of outfield.
Yeah, they have plenty of guys who can play outfield.
So you could easily just call up Chavis. You look at Wilson's not really a guy you can call up. Ronaldo Hernandez, double-A guy, can't really call him up. Jason Rosario, double-A guy, can't really call him up. A guy who fits both descriptions, Hudson Potts, isn't a guy you would call up yet, and he's hurt.
Yeah.
And Jay Groom you can't call up.
Well, I think this is also – I was kind of looking at it. This is why we might talk about it a little bit. I don't think, like, we're seeing Jaron Duran anytime soon. There's not a spot for him to play in the outfield. And the bigger issue, I think, right now is they just don't have the 40-man spots to add another player.
Well, they do and they don't. I mean, so and the other thing, the other one we should mention is Brian Mata's on the 40-man roster, and he's on the long-term IL. And I did want to point this out. Many have said, well, you could put Mata on the 60-day injured list and get him off of the 40.
You want to explain why they're not going to do that?
That's what I'm about to do.
Yeah,
is that you don't want to do that with Mata, because to put a guy on the 60-man IL or 60-day IL. Pardon me. He has to be on the major league roster, which means A, you are paying him a major league salary as opposed to a AAA salary. And B, much, much, much more importantly, he's accruing service time. With Mata, I admittedly don't know how it would work transitioning between seasons, because obviously there's no injured list during the offseason, so he would come off the injured list during the offseason.
Yeah.
But I think you would need to put him back on the IL next year. I don't think you can just option him.
It's not like a minor leaguer, but with the Chris Sale situation, he had to come off in the offseason and then they put him right back on in March.
But you had to, because you weren't going to option him, is my point.
Well, exactly, like, but I don't know if you can option an injured guy. I don't, because if he's injured and he's on the major league DL, you can't option, like, there's the MLBPA.
Well, but again, it's was he on the IL? Like, here's the thing, right? You can't put Mata on the 60-day IL now.
Yeah.
And take him off in 60 days when he's still hurt. He needs to stay on it whole year.
Exactly.
I don't know how it works for next year. If it works that way for next year, you're now talking about 2 years of team control you're giving up for a 40-man roster spot, so that you don't have to DFA Colton Brewer.
Exactly. There's only one player who would somewhat make sense to do this with, and I think we've talked about it privately.
I tweeted it too. Is that with Hudson Potts, he's on the 40-man. It's very clear. I mean, he's clearly not going to be ready within 60 days. You could put him on the 60-day IL. When you quote-unquote would activate him, he could stay on a rehab assignment. So you could drag that out another 20 days of quote-unquote rehab assignment once he's ready to play again.
Well, yeah, because if he went on the 60-day, I think the 60-day, the deadline.
It's from the start of the year.
It's June, like, 3rd or whatever, or June 1st, I think, is when.
He's clearly not going to be back, yeah.
And so then you could push that with the rehab assignment till mid-July, potentially, which that buys you a lot of time. But the trade-off is, obviously, as you said, you know, you're paying, he's getting service time, and you're paying him MLB salary.
And that counts towards the CBT. It's not just a money thing, it's a CBT thing to pay a guy to be on the major league roster. But here's the thing with Potts, is that because in theory he's going to be activated at some point soon, I'm okay with Hudson Potts, a double A guy, getting a month or two of service time. Right? It probably wouldn't even be 2 months.
I think it's also more the prospect status thing. Like a guy like Mata coming off TJ pitchers, you're going to want that those service times saved. Versus Potts, it's not as big a deal, I don't think, because if you run into service time considerations with him, then
it's a good position to be in. It means that he panned out, because the thing is, Mott is a much better prospect. Potts isn't a bad prospect. He's in the top 20 for us, I think, or he might have. No, he's 21 now.
Outside the top 20.
Right outside the top 20.
Next, maybe, because of graduations, but yeah.
Yeah,
because
Garrett Whitlock is going to graduate on June 1st.
He actually might not, because someone is.
He might not. Well, Bayo's going to leapfrog him at least. So he maybe not. But anyway, yeah, I mean, I could see you doing that with Potts. But that said, you've got also on the 40-man, Colton Brewer. I think Brandon Brennan, who's pitching pretty well in Worcester, is pitching his way into, like, I think they'd be comfortable calling him up at this point.
But, I mean, he has to be. He's literally the only, like, other than Brewer, he's the only pitching depth.
Yeah, and but this is why Matt Andreese is getting stretched out.
Mm-hmm.
Matt Andreese is getting stretched out because he's the guy who's starting if they need him.
Because, well, yeah, he's now the sixth starter because they didn't have one before.
So that's why, you know, on Sunday they pitched him for, what was it, 3 or 4 innings, because they're trying to stretch him back out in case they need someone to – they need to get a spot start for someone. You know,
well, yeah,
you look at Eduardo Rodriguez, who's struggling lately.
It's also why I think we're seeing the flip side with Garrett Whitlock, who is not throwing as long now, because they're pretty clearly transitioning him just being a reliever for this year.
Yeah, yeah. So it's and the other piece of it, too, that you have to remember is that it used to be a 25-man roster with a 40-man reserve list, including the active roster guys. Now you've got a situation where you've made the Major League active roster 26 without a corresponding increase in the 40-man roster. So you're removing one reserve player. So when you have that many guys who are on the 40-man roster to protect them from the Rule 5 draft, who are just prospects, they just don't really run very deep right now. They've got, and that's part of why the versatility of Kike Hernandez, Marwin Gonzalez, Danny Santana is so crucial, because no matter who in the lineup gets hurt, Michael Chavis is who you call up. Hunter Renfro gets hurt, call up Michael Chavis. You just play Santana and Hernandez and Gonzalez in the outfield. And Chavis starts at second and first.
Mm-hmm.
You know what I mean? The only difference would be like a catcher. And the thing is, that's why you've got Chris Herman and Jet Bandy. You call one of them up and DFA them when you're done with them.
Exactly, like, yeah. You just DFA if you had to.
Defungible depth.
You just DFA a pitcher.
Right. And like if Wong is healthy, yeah, sure, call Connor Wong up for 2 weeks. Whatever. I'm cool with it, you know? So, yeah, so that's kind of it's an interesting situation that they find themselves in where, like, they don't have a lot of depth, but because of how they've built the Major League roster, they don't really need it.
Well, again, that's the thing is, like, even if, let's say, something happens to Chavis, you just call Arauz up, and he spent all of last year at the majors, and they've shown they're perfectly fine playing him, like, in a utility role.
He can
like
at least field
player.
The position. Like,
exactly. And, I mean, he's hitting decently in Worcester this year.
I'm going
to do that
times.
So much.
Yeah.
In Worcester this year, he's not anymore. He was off to a good start. I mean, he's getting on base, got, like, a .330 OBP
on
base.
Well, he's also been up and down, so you can't really read too much in stats 3 weeks.
He had two hits in, you know, two hits up when he was with Boston, like, he's serviceable at least. Like you're comfortable putting him out there. Then that's all you can really ask for your like your sixth string middle infielder.
And maybe we could transition from there, Ian, into we need to talk again about Jaron Duran and Tristan Casas, who are continuing to I shouldn't say continuing. Duran had one 5-for-5 game this week with two bombs and a double. But before that he was actually in a little bit of a mini slump. And here's the thing, because after the 5-for-5 game, so many people were like, oh my God, why is he still in AAA? Blah, blah, you know, look at how good he's hitting. First of all, he had had like a 5-game slump before that. Okay. Second of all,
I have it right here. In the 7 games before that, he was 148, 281, 333.
Mini slump.
Yeah.
Part of that was probably ball and play luck, if I remember right. Right.
I mean, he was striking out a ton.
We'll see. Okay.
He had like 9 strikeouts and 25 at bats or something.
Yeah. Okay. So he had that. He had the one huge, huge game. I think he went 0 for again yesterday, right?
Yes, he was 0 for 5 yesterday.
Yeah. So first of all, he had one good game this week. Second of all, the Worcester Red Sox have had 3 series.
Yep.
Two of them are against Syracuse, right?
No,
two against Buffalo. One against Syracuse. Syracuse.
No, Syracuse is really bad.
Has by far the worst pitching staff in the AAA East.
Well, part of that's not their fault, though, because their entire team is up with the Mets, because the Mets have, like,
true.
Literally their entire
roster. But it doesn't matter whose fault it is. It matters that's the pitchers he was facing.
Right,
that he's beating up on. Yeah. Buffalo, here's the thing. Just to show how small a sample size this is, this fact doesn't matter, but it's just an example of how small the sample size is. Jaron Duran has yet to play a AAA game on the road against a team that's in its usual home park.
Yeah, because they played that first game in Trenton.
In Trenton. And then series in Worcester. Two of the huge games were with the Jetstream going out.
Yeah, and that's the thing. The Worcester numbers this year, I don't know what we're going to do with them, because when the wind is blowing out there, that park plays like a Little League park. It's absurd, like, as we kind of talked about. And they're going to play a lot of games there this year, obviously. So
yeah,
when the wind's blowing out, there's not a lot you can do. But
really
we should
isn't.
Say, Duran's 5-for-5 game, his two home runs were absolute monster shots. Like,
Jacks.
He hit, I think it was 475 and 480 off track, man.
Mm-hmm.
Like, he hit it out of the ballpark, both of them. So
yeah, they were just, they're majestic.
You know,
yeah.
Yeah. But I just think that it's the combo of kind of what you said. He's been up and down the 40-man situation. And then the biggest reason is he's not going to be with the Red Sox for the next 2 weeks, and they've made that abundantly clear that he's going to that. So.
Yeah. Well, so, I mean, the thing is, I wanted to mention that with Duran, just when you look at the sample size. The other thing I wanted to mention really quick in Worcester, because people have brought his name up, Yairo Munoz is a name I keep seeing on Twitter and stuff like that. Look, Yairo Munoz is not coming up, ladies and gentlemen. He's playing only third base in Worcester. For the most part, he played first base the other day.
Yeah.
But he's not playing any outfield.
Yep.
He's playing third base, a position where he's only going to maybe get a look if Devers gets hurt.
But he wouldn't, because they would just put
put Marwin Gonzalez.
Marwin Gonzalez there, or Danny Santana
exactly.
there or something. Yeah.
Yairo Munoz is not a consideration right now. He's also not hitting all that great.
He's 259, 279, 345 with 15 strikeouts, one walk.
Yeah, he's not a consideration. So forget about Yairo Munoz.
Munoz.
Sorry.
They took him off the 40-man for a reason. They've got plenty of depth for what you said. And then they've got Chavis and Arauz already ahead of him on the 40-man. Like, there's no point in adding him. It's just
he's completely redundant with Chavis and Arauz. And
he's
redundant with what they have in Boston. No question. But getting back to the point you were transitioning to, that I screwed up the transition. Also coming up, running from Memorial Day through the rest of that week, is the America's Olympic Qualifier. It's an 8-team tournament taking place in West Palm Beach in Florida, including Team USA, Team Colombia, Team Venezuela. It's USA, Colombia, Venezuela, Dominican Republic, Puerto Rico, which I still don't understand how Puerto Rico gets its own Olympic team.
Canada,
Nicaragua, Colombia. That's 8. Oh,
yep.
Did you say Canada?
Yeah, I did.
Okay.
I just said Canada.
You said Canada. Okay, good. Those 8 teams. The Red Sox top 3 prospects are going. Tristan Casas and Jaron Duran are going to play or they're at least on the preliminary roster for Team USA. I can't imagine they don't make it.
Well, especially because I forgot this. Darren Fencer's coaching the team. So the Red Sox
he's
have
a third
coach
base
down
coach.
There too.
Yep.
So yeah, like.
Yep. He's currently the infield coordinator, I think, for the system.
Let's just say they're making the team.
Well, they also wouldn't have let them go out to be on the preliminary roster and not make it.
That was my point. What I was going to get to is they're letting these guys go. They most likely have a guarantee they're making the team.
Exactly. So, yeah. So there's that they're making it. Then Jeter Downs and his brother Jerry are playing for Team Colombia.
Yep.
Because they were both born in Colombia. By the way, interesting, Jerry is listed as an outfielder, which would partially explain why he hasn't been assigned to a team yet. He was probably in Fort Myers working on playing outfield.
Oh, that does make sense, actually.
Yeah. So, because, I mean, there's just, where's he going to get playing time as a first baseman?
Yeah, and he was a first baseman. Yeah, it makes sense.
And then finally, the fifth guy from the system who's going is pitcher Emmanuel De Jesus is going to play for Team Venezuela as a pitcher. He was working out of the Portland bullpen, made one spot start this week in place of Thaddeus Ward.
Yep.
He was piggybacked in that game by Matt Kent, which makes me think Kent, who's been hot lately, and we're going to talk about him in a bit, is going to get that rotation spot. So,
yeah.
But that said, I mean, it's interesting that they're going to lose all of those guys for 2 weeks.
Yep, they're gone this week, next week, and I would assume maybe a day or two the following week as they kind of like get reintegrated with the team. Maybe there's COVID protocols they have to go
Could
through,
be.
whatever.
There could be. That's true.
But yeah, I mean, and I saw some like people tweeting like they were concerned about, oh, what if they get hurt, blah, blah, blah. There's no more injury risk there than if they're playing their own games. Like, the Red Sox have a coach down there. I'm not really worried about
Well,
it.
and you know, first of all, there's only one pitcher, and that pitcher is, let's face it, an Orc guy in DeJesus.
Yep.
But if you look back at the Premier 12 tournament, the Red Sox let Tanner Houck and Noah Song play along with Bobby Dalbec and CJ Chatham.
Exactly.
You
Yeah.
know,
And
they see it as valuable experience.
When I think if you look at the preliminary rosters, like the level of competition is definitely at least equivalent to AAA. Like you have, especially for Team USA, there's a bunch of ex-major leaguers on that team, like
David
Homer Bailey,
Robertson, yeah.
Homer Bailey, David Robertson. It's just a bunch of guys, you know, trying to get back into the big leagues. And so I think it'll be good experience for the for those young guys, you know, getting out and being, you know, getting to pick the mind of some veteran players,
Sure.
get to face some different type of pitchers, because especially with how like the minor league setup is this year, they're going to be facing the same what four teams over and over again,
I don't
or
know if it's
five
the same
teams
four teams, but it's like five or
or
six.
whatever. It's the
Yeah, because
teams
the
in their
AAA
division.
East is pretty big.
It's the same teams in their division though, so you know they're going to get to experience some new arms. They're going to get a kind of an intense competition that actually has some stakes, whereas I don't think there's any like playoffs or anything in the minor leagues this year.
No, there's no
So
playoffs because they
yeah,
got rid of them
so
to make the regular season longer.
which I think is a perfectly defensible thing. Don't
Oh,
get me wrong, but
yeah.
these have stakes. I mean, this is the only qualifier. So, yeah, I think it's going to be a good experience for them, and I'm excited to kind of get a look at see how they handle themselves down there.
And to make an and to make another point, I was asked this on Twitter. The Duran thing, someone asked, well, what about the Olympics? This roster is just for the qualifier tournament. It doesn't mean these guys are definitely playing in the Olympics. I will be honest, I will be very surprised if Duran is on the Olympic team.
I would be too,
Because by
because the
that
Olympic
point,
team, that's what, July?
July, late July.
Yeah.
Yeah, I would be stunned if they let him play in that because of the fact that at that point, he probably is a consideration for the Major League roster. I
Yeah.
could see Casas potentially. I could see
I can see that, man.
Jerry Downs at least. Jeter
Jeter Downs is an
maybe.
interesting one because we'll talk about him in a little bit, how he's been performing. But if he continues to hit, I mean, you could make the case that there might be a spot for him at some point later in the year.
Yeah, definitely. I mean, that's also it is a very interesting one. Yeah, we'll have to see how it goes, but we'll update you here on how things are going down in West Palm with those guys. So that was just kind of it's an interesting note that they've got. I can't remember them having the top guys in the system gone like that at any point. You know, even the Premier 12 tournament was like the off season. That wasn't even during the regular season, right? It was like right after the season ended. So anyway, yeah, talking about the 40 man, we talked about injuries. Ian, let's talk about Salem.
Sure. Why not?
I got to see the Salem Red Sox play the worst team in the minor leagues in Fredericksburg in the Fredericksburg Nationals. As
Wait, did
I'm
you see the Fredericksburg win?
there's set winning what?
Did you see Fredericksburg win?
No, I didn't
No,
see the
you didn't
win.
go
The
through
win
the day they
happened
won.
on Tuesday or Wednesday, which was their
Okay,
only win
sorry.
so far this year.
Yeah, they're 1-17, I think.
Yeah, as I was telling Ian, Fredericksburg the night I went, their lineup consisted of one guy with a OPS over 600, one guy with an OPS over 500, another with an OPS of 400, 500, and the other six were below 500. Again, OPS. I've never seen anything like it. If you know, this week the pitching staff for Salem, they had I think five guys in contention for the pitcher of the week poll. It's and Jordan DiValerio made his way on there. It was just kind of it was fascinating how bad that team was.
Well, and it's like it's kind of like the reverse of the Salem bats just like destroyed them. I think they scored 10 runs like several times, and it's the same thing Greenville. I think a lot of the Greenville hitters are in, running for the player of the week, and I was
Yeah.
talking to a scout who was watching them last week, and he was like, that actual pitching staff might be the worst pitching staff in minor league baseball. Like
Really?
it is absolutely atrocious.
I didn't
And
realize that.
yeah, they scored like 14, 13. Like the Greenville was just putting an absurd number of runs last week. I don't know if you have their schedule up and
I don't.
have the results. Let me see if I can bring it up. Here it is. Greenville's games were they lost 13-12, 3-2, 7-6. They put up 15 runs, 7 runs, and 3 runs.
Yikes.
So, yeah, they had two double digits and two high single digits as well. So, out of the 7-6 games. So, not great.
That is bananas. That is absolutely bananas. Yeah, but anyway, first of all, I should say Fredericksburg, new ballpark, loved it. Had some really interesting craft beer selections there that I want to go as a fan sometime and try. I was tempted to do it, but frankly, with the way what I do now is I kind of bounce around. When Salem's pitching, I'm behind home plate getting velocities, and when they're hitting, I try and get video from the baselines. And in fact, I think I got video of every hitter in the lineup. It's an interesting Salem lineup. I saw, let's see, I guess I'll just take it from the top with the lineup. Gilberto Jimenez didn't do a whole lot. I think he had a single at the plate, but I did get to see him hit from both sides of the plate because the Fredericksburg starter was a lefty. And Jimenez, it's just striking how much different his swing is from each side of the plate. We've talked about it on here, but he still does it. It is I would just call it a more standard swing from the right side, where he's, you know, a little more upright, swings with a little more authority.
We saw yesterday he hit a home run, his first home run of the year, right-handed, and it just looked like a pretty normal swing.
It looks like you expect the swing to look. From the left side, he chokes up, like noticeably, crouches, and he's just slash and burn. And, you know, I've gone back and forth about it. We've discussed it plenty off air. You know, it's interesting that he's going with that because we heard all about how instructs the last 2 years he was working on, you know, swing tweaks in his mechanics, and he has had much higher exit velocities this year. You've gotten the details on that.
Yeah.
You know, it's way up, and that's a good thing.
His quality of contact's up. He's hitting the ball harder.
Yep.
Way up more often. He's really swinging. He's not chasing as much. Like all the advanced data with him at the plate is very encouraging, and his stat line, I mean, he's hitting like 350 on the year. Like it's hard to complain with what he's doing.
Yeah. He's hitting 352, 403, 479 with the one homer, 6 doubles. He's 4-for-4 in steal attempts. I'm kind of surprised he's only tried to steal 4 times.
He's got a career low K rate. It's not that much. And part of it is because I think he had 2 strikeouts yesterday.
He never strikes out anyway, though. He's at 13% for the year.
Yeah, the other thing is his line drive rate is career high. His pull rate is a career high, which is a good thing. Which the pull rate makes sense when you think about the exit velo numbers are up because you pull the ball harder. And I think that's where the strength is showing. It might not be that he's changed the swing. The added strength, I think, is showing in the exit velos and the pull, his ability to pull the ball because his bat's not dragging as much through the zone.
Yep.
Whereas even if he's still slapping at the ball, he can at least get around on it now.
Right. Whereas before he was slapping at it and everything was the other way.
Was just like a weak ground ball to the left side. Whereas now he's at least, you know, pulling the ball on the ground or pulling the ball on a line drive.
Right.
And it's a weird profile. It's a throwback profile. It's just it's just an interesting one because, as you said, you know, we've had a lot of debates about, like, does he need to change? And I do wonder if the Red Sox have reached a point where they're just comfortable with him being this guy. Like, from the right side, it's normal-ish. You know, he'll have some pop. From the left side, maybe he'll run into a home run or two, but it's mostly just going to be, you know, put the ball in play and run. So we'll see.
Yeah, I mean, it's can Juan Pierre work now? And the thing is, that puts so much pressure on the hit tool. So we'll have to see if he can keep this up.
Yeah.
Next up in the order was Matthew Lugo, another top 20 guy in the system. Super athletic. You can see what they liked. Looks the part. And I would actually put both him and Nick York into this category of, you know, I think Lugo was 0-for. Nick York had one hit. We posted the video on Instagram. He just went, you know, right back up the middle. Nice, you know, solid swing. They both.
What's the Instagram for people who don't follow it?
Oh, at Sox Prospects. Thank you. Yes. No, at Sox Prospects. Make sure you check that out. We're trying to get video up there now when we get to games. But
you also have great graphics and stuff. So
we do. Yeah. Sean is killing it on that. But with York and Lugo, they don't look lost, right? I'm not going to say they look lost by any stretch of the imagination. They don't look like they're pressing. They don't look frustrated. But when you look at the two of them, you know, They have eerily similar numbers this year. York is 12 for 61. Lugo is 13 for 62. They both have 18 strikeouts. York has walked 6 times. Lugo has yet to walk this year in 15 starts, I just noticed, which is crazy to think about. Both have 2 steals, which is kind of crazy for York, who's not fast. They just look like they're still figuring it out, which is okay. They're both young and their first taste of full season ball. York is in his first taste of professional baseball. I'm not worried about them yet. Like I said, they're up there. They look the part. I think they'll figure it out. In the field, I didn't see Jimenez do anything in the field. Lugo, it's kind of funny. I made a note early in the game. He had one throw from short that was just absolute garbage. And I was like, what is this, like a 40 arm? But then later in the game, he had one play ranging to his right, another play charging in and barehanding the ball where he did show off. He's got at least a 55, maybe 60, probably more of a 55 arm. Looked confident. The hands were pretty good. 50, 55 hands, maybe. Looked pretty good on a couple turns. York in the field, I didn't love it. Not a ton of range. The arm is adequate for second. It's maybe a 40, 45 arm for second. He looked fine. He didn't look good. He looked fine. We'll have to see if he can work. I think he needs to get better to stick at second in the majors.
Yeah, I mean, that kind of squares with what we heard from, you know, instructs and camp this year, is that, like, the bat is going to be – he's going to have to get there with the bat. He's not going to add much value on defense. It's not, you know, maybe it's – at best, he's probably like a 40, 45 defender even at second base. So he's going to have to hit, and that's kind of, you know, it was an aggressive assignment, and we'll still wait and see. But as you said, it's, you know, it's good that at least he doesn't look that out of his element there.
Yeah, yeah. And then the one last guy that I wanted to really highlight on his own was, and I was supposed to look up how you say his name, but I forgot. But Sadan Rafaela, he looks wiry. He looks very athletic. He's fast. Again, also kind of finding his way. He's hitting a little bit better than those other guys. He's 14 for 51. He played center field, actually, and I really liked him in center.
I saw that. I saw he's played some center.
Yeah.
He's played second and third also, right?
Yeah. Yep. Well, he had played second and third previously. He'd played some short too, but I think he's not going to see a lot of short there with Matthew Lugo there. And I think they've got Jake McKenzie there to be the backup shortstop. But Rafaela, I kind of liked him in center. He showed a little bit of range, really easy, athletic out there. He had one play where he kind of ranged a little bit to his left and kind of did like a half jump just to make the play easily rather than kind of, you know, making it harder than it needed to be. He had one throw to the plate that was pretty darn good. I would call it an above average arm from center, at least. I liked him out there. He's a very intriguing player. So he caught my eye as well. He's probably going to be higher in my rankings this month based on what I saw out of him there. And then the rest of that lineup, I didn't see Nick Decker. I didn't see Nick Northcutt. Most of the rest of that lineup are
Joe Davis, my favorite player on that team.
Our college guys. I didn't see Steven Scott either, who was, I think, our player of the week the first week of the season. But they have a bunch of college guys who are hitting really well right now. Will Dalton is hitting 308, 391, 538. He had the best struck ball of the night. Fredericksburg's starter actually looked pretty good and did pretty well in his five innings, I think. But Dalton stroked one to the warning track that the Fredericksburg center fielder made a really nice play on.
Well, and I think he homered twice on Sunday, too.
Yeah, I mean, he's clearly got some pop. Jax Groshans is having a pretty good year, 314, 468, 429, more walks than strikeouts. Scott's having a good year, Joe Davis. They've got Alex
Arrow. Give us the Joe Davis line. Don't sleep on the Joe Davis line.
The Joe Davis line is 326, 411, 435.
Yep,
he's a guy
Joe,
that goes
baby
up and hit. He's got a caught stealing, which is, I've got to assume that's a pickoff.
I need to go find that video.
Oh, I should mention, this was so funny.
Majestic.
He scored on a wild pitch, and he came in, and he just starts screaming at the dugout. He's like, I'm so effing fast. He's just like, I'm so fast. I love Big Joe.
Oh, he's the best. Him and Lowell in 2019 was one of the most joyful experiences. He had this little stretch near the end of the year. I think it might have been in the playoffs.
It was in the playoffs when he had the big hit consecutive nights.
Yeah, he had like walk-offs and back-to-back nights, and it was just absolutely incredible. He's just It's a majestic human being.
But it's just like they've got these college guys that are going to go up and put together professional at-bats and extend the lineup. And we talked about how the top of the lineup at the beginning of the year was Jimenez, York, Lugo, I think.
Yeah.
And they moved York down in the order. And I think that makes sense because when you've got guys like...
They dropped
like,
Lugo, too.
Lugo was second the night I was there. Did they drop him yesterday?
Second. He's been hitting sixth a lot of the time.
Oh, really? Because he hit second the night I was there. It might have been because Decker was down.
They've had Decker hitting third, I believe.
Okay. At any rate, interesting. But you don't want to have Lugo and York next to each other because that just slows the lineup down. You know what I mean? So they've got Jimenez at the top, the game I was there, followed by Lugo. And then I think it was like Groshans, Davis. There might have been one other guy. And then it was like York, Rafaela. And then Jacora Arnold, who's kind of struggling this year, and he's really playing a part-time role. But they can extend that lineup. They've got guys that are interesting. I mean, I'm interested to see mid-year, like Jax Groshans. Does he get a call up to Greenville as a college guy? I could see it if he keeps hitting like this. It depends on the defense. I didn't really see a lot out of him either way. I don't think anyone ran on him.
Yeah. I think the problem is they just have kind of a logjam of guys, though, even at Greenville, like – all the Greenville guys are hitting too because Greenville is just murdering the ball right now.
Yeah.
And like if you call them up, you know, Cole Cottom's playing catcher and then they have the Moreros as backups and, you know, Alan Morero can't really hit, but he can call a heck of a game and he's a very good defender. So they like playing him and Eli Morero is actually hitting a little bit this year.
Mm-hmm.
Then at first base, they've got Tyreek Reed who's killing the ball this year. His slugging is like over 700.
Yeah.
Second base, Cannon, same thing. He's hitting really well this year. Third base, Brandon Howlett's hitting really well. Shortstops, Christian, like they just have a bunch of like college guys or, you know, guys who are belong in high A. So that's kind of what I think some of these guys just got caught in the numbers game.
Yeah. And you think the thing too, is it's like, you could say, well, we'll chain promote them all. It's like, well, then where do the guys in AAA go?
Well, that's the thing is I do wonder if like, we'll see, I don't think it's now, but in like whenever, when does the GCL start? In end of July?
Do we even know? I don't think even know.
We might not know.
We don't even know what's happening with the GCL. June,
but
maybe. Who knows?
But like,
I don't think it is. I think it might be after the draft. No, it can't be because they're not going to wait till after. They're not going to wait till after
before the draft. Yeah. I thought it was end of June.
It probably. I mean, it usually is. I don't know if that's what's going to happen this year. I don't even.
But like, if you look at the Portland roster, they do have some guys that could play there. But at the same time, it's I want to see Cameron Cannon have an extended run of success before I'm promoting him to Double A.
Oh yeah.
Like
yeah.
Like Grant Williams is playing second base every day and. Portland, like I like Grant Williams a lot as an org player, but he's not like if there's a prospect coming through, Grant Williams will move to the bench.
Yeah,
but I don't want to promote Cannon yet because I don't think he's ready. And I talking to scouts about Greenville, they kind of agree. Yes, the numbers are good, but there's a lot of luck in those numbers from what I've heard. And so I want to see more of that, more of him, you know, consistently performing week in and week out before I'm moving him up. Same thing with a guy like Christian Koss, Brandon Hallett. So that's the kind of the quandary there, yeah. I would say.
I mean, the thing is with we always get asked around this time of year for elite prospects who are destroying their level. Usually they're not getting called up before about 150 at bats.
Yeah.
That's like at the earliest. That's like Mookie Betts making a mockery of the Eastern League.
Or like Jaren Duran when he was in Lowell that year.
Yeah. I mean, like in Salem, he had basically half a year of hitting 400.
Yeah, I guess he did that again too. Yeah.
Yeah. So it's like 150 at bats. Usually it's more like 200, 250. And guys right now, you look at like Jimenez is at 71 at bats.
Yeah. Yeah, and he's the leadoff hitter. He probably has the most at bats of like anyone in the organization.
Probably, yeah. Duran probably has more because I think Duran's the only guy who's played all 18 games.
Maybe, but I'm looking at Duran. So Duran got promoted in Lowell. He got 155 at bats, and in Salem, he got 199. Right. And in both of those, he was hitting like almost. He was hitting 350 in Lowell and almost 400 in Salem. So,
Duran has 72 at bats to Jimenez's 71, but Duran also has walked 10 times to Jimenez's 3.
Yeah.
So going by plate appearances, it's Duran at 82, Jimenez at 77, Tyler Esplin at 76, and Kristen Casas at 75.
Yeah.
Cannon Castellanos, Jeter Downs.
It's what it should be. The top prospects are getting the at-bats. Like, let's be honest. That's what it should be.
Pitching side of the ball, I saw Jeremy Wu Yellen start. I liked what I saw out of him. I missed the first inning because of traffic, because 95 was an absolute mess coming in from DC.
I mean, we've all been there in DC traffic before.
Well, yeah. I mean, maybe not
I've
listening
gone
to this
out.
show, but you certainly have.
I have been there going out to Frederick before, and it
Yeah.
is not fun.
No, it's it yeah, that drive sucks. But Wu Yelland, I mean, I liked it. He was, what did I say? I think it was like 91 to 92 and some 94s in there, which makes me think two seam, four seam from the left side. He kind of slings
Could
it.
be like 91 or 93, though. He could just be like 91 or 93, T94.
Yeah. I mean, it could be. It could be. It's just the way it was two very different. He was like, 94, 94, 91, 92,
If it was
whatever.
two different shapes, then
94.
it could be 4-2.
It could
He has
be.
the arm slot of someone who would throw a two-seam fastball,
Oh, for
like if you've
sure.
seen his delivery, because
Yeah.
he kind of like cross bodies it like from the low slot. Yeah, I mean,
Yeah.
sorry, I don't
No,
want to
it's
mean to
fine. And then
interrupt.
he, yeah, no, it's fine. And then he threw a change up and a slider. I liked if it was this change up, the change up. It's entirely possible. We've got in his scouting report that the slider is more vertical. The slider that I saw, he at least was throwing a slider that was sweepier.
Interesting. Yeah, because I remember I talk well, talking to scouts. We were able to get a look at some of his TrackMan stuff, and it was it didn't grade well really scouting in person, but on the it had a really good spin rate if I remember correctly, and like the
Yes.
shape graded out really well.
Yes.
So
Well,
yeah,
he
I
check
wonder
out the
if
video because I got a little bit of him warming up and I put it on Instagram. So
yeah.
check out the Instagram because he throws a slider that's definitely not a vertical slider.
Yeah,
It's
so I
definitely a
that,
sweepy slider.
well, the thing is too, because what you've got to remember is that what he was throwing last season was basically in instructs was what he threw in the college season. They're not
Right.
really going to tweak anything in instructs. They get a look at what they for often how they do it is they'll get that look at what the guys have coming out of the draft in that first season, and then they work on things in camp that this year is kind of the first time they'll tweak, grips, arm slot, release points, things like that.
Yeah, and I think they
So.
worked with him on his changeup because the changeup I had 82 to 85 and it flashed really nice drop. I
Yeah.
mean, I'm tempted to call it plus drop,
Yeah.
a potential, like it flashed plus. It was really nice. He threw some really nice ones. And he was definitely working on the off speed because he would like triple up on him.
Who is the Salem pitching coach by chance?
I don't
Is it
know it
Nick
off the
Green?
top of my head. I don't think it is.
Let me look.
You can look it up while I talk. But then the slider was 81 to 82, which makes me think that some of those 82 mile per hour quote change ups might have been a slider with a different shape that he didn't get on the side of. I don't know. The angle I was at was kind of high up, so I couldn't really get spins. But it was I liked what I saw out of him. He's a guy that's going to be moving up. I had him in like the 50 to 60 range. I'll probably have him. I might even move him to my top 40, to be frank.
And no, it is Nick Green. Nick Green's the changeup
He's the
master.
changeup guru.
Yeah,
Yeah.
that
So
makes
that makes
sense. His
sense.
changeup's getting better.
Yeah. He was followed by Jordan DiValerio, who's off to a great start this year. I didn't love the stuff.
No, but but he knows how to pitch
He
so
mixes
well.
four pitches
Yeah.
and knows how to do it. He's gonna have success at this level. He was.
I was talking to a scout about him earlier this week or last week, and
He
yeah, and he
mixed it
was like,
well. He's 89 to 91 with the fastball. Lot of curves at 76 to 78. Through a changeup and a split that it's funny. Like I love when I show up at games, think something, look at our scouting report, and it's in there already. It was really hard to differentiate between his changeup and splitter, which were both 79 to 81.
Yeah, it throws them the exact same velocity, but you could tell they're two different pitches by the
Yeah.
spin
And
rates.
you could tell when he's warming up for the inning when he's like telling the catcher what's coming and
Yeah,
he's saying changeup and then he's changing splitter, or saying
yeah,
splitter.
yeah.
He mixed all four pitches. Really wasn't challenged against Fredericksburg. He threw against them twice this week, which is why at this point too, like two of his four outings are against the worst team in the minor leagues. You got to be
But
careful with stats at this point, but he looked pretty good. I liked it. I still think he's a maybe upper. I need to see him in double A before I'm a believer, but I liked it. He might sneak into my top 60.
he'll be in my top 60. I was
Yeah.
basically I was talking to a scout who saw him this year, and also has seen him prior, and his thing was just like, there's not a lot of upside. Like, he's a 23-year-old facing low A hitters. I
Yeah.
need to see it in the high minors, kind of like what you said.
Yes.
But at the same time, like, he really knows how to pitch.
He
He
does.
has good feel for all his pitches. He really knows how to locate. I mean, he's got 17 strikeouts, no walks on the year, 12 and two-thirds innings. I would assume he's probably the favorite for pitcher of the month at this point. I would have
Might
to
be.
think that he's or at least in contention for that. Like, he just really knows how to pitch. And I think that he's someone we could see promoted pretty soon, because like the scout was like, let's be honest, he could probably face double A hitters right now and not miss a breeze. Like,
I don't know about double A. He could certainly go to high A with that arsenal.
No, but like double A would be a more appropriate challenge, was the point.
He's thrown 12 innings without allowing a run, and he's got 17 strikeouts to no walks.
He's given up like six hits. Yeah.
Yeah. I mean, with he's 4-0 in five games.
Yeah. So like, that's just, I mean, he's just like one of those guys that,
yeah.
The biggest takeaway is basically just like, don't be surprised if this guy pitches in a big league game at some point. He might not stick around, question. But he's going to pitch in a big league game. I have written up in my report. Mm-hmm. So yeah, like he's an interesting guy, and he's someone that it's under the radar, but it just works.
He keeps posting numbers like this. He's not going to be under the radar for very
exactly.
long.
Exactly.
Yeah. He's looking right now, like unless he throws a couple stinkers to end the month, he's in the running for pitcher of the month. Anything else, anyone else you were wondering about? The other pitchers I saw were Brandon Walter, who just kind of is an orgy guy from the left side, and Cody Scroggins, who, you know, throws hard from the right hand side. It's funny, they pitched him after he'd thrown 2 days prior, which was weird. I don't know if they're planning on moving him quickly or something, or I don't know. That was just very strange.
Yeah, that was strange.
But yeah, I mean, he was, you know, like I said, he threw hard. He was like 92 to 95.
Yeah. I would say not something on what you saw, but I just think we should touch on Jorge Rodriguez briefly, because we talked about in his last that his stuff had been down. Well, I heard his stuff was back to normal this week.
Because he had a very good outing this week.
Yeah, it was like four innings, a couple strikeouts. I have it right here. Four innings, two hits, four strikeouts, one walk. Well, he was up to 93, like fastballs like 91 and 92 mostly, which is – yeah, so his stuff was fine, and that's kind of what we talk about when, you know, it's nice to have these early season velocities, but there are going to be blips where guys just, you know, take a couple outings to get warmed up. They have an off day, like things like that. So that's why, you know, you don't want to read too much into those velocity readings early in the season.
Yep, or just results.
Well, exactly that also, yeah.
Just generally, you know, you need to see why the results are what they are. So this team is a fun team to go see, because they've got prospects, but they've also got those interesting college guys that can help turn the lineup over and can help shut down the other.
It's like a Lowell team.
It's like a good Lowell team, though.
No, I know.
Like, like when they have like, it's Lowell when they've got a good set of young guys from the prior draft.
And then they have the draftees coming in.
And a bunch of good day two college guys that come in. I mean, that's what this team is.
Exactly.
It's interesting. Like Alex Arrow is like the other catcher. He's like catching just as much as Groshans is,
and he's hitting over 300 too.
Yeah, so it's a fun team to see. I'm looking forward to I'm going to see them hopefully for more games when they come back to Fredericksburg.
I'm hoping at some point I'll be able to get down there and see them this year. We'll see how the schedule falls, but
come stay at Casa Hatfield, man.
Well, you have a cat, that's not gonna happen,
and a dog that will probably bark at you.
I don't care about the dog and the cat's the issue.
Yeah. Fair enough. What else we got? Do we want to check some levels?
All right, let's do it.
Check some levels really quick. All right, checking levels is brought to you by...
nothing.
Eddie's Goat Milk? No, that's taken. I don't know.
Let's just move on.
Let's figure out a sponsor later. All right, we already talked about Salem. We're going to skip Salem. Let's start at the bottom of the next level up in the system in Greenville, High A. We're each just going to do one guy, period, at each level. So why don't you go first, Ian?
So my player is a pitcher. The hitters had really good weeks, but we kind of like talked about Tyreek Reed is just murdering the ball. Like the bats can really play. And my interesting guy, or the guy I was going to talk about, is Alex Scherff. I feel like he's kind of like a forgotten man around here. You know, he's a 2017 draftee, got well over slot in the fifth round. And let's being honest, he's really struggled up until this point in his career.
Yeah, absolutely. We were very confident they were going to move him into the rotation this year, put it that way.
So he's moved to the bullpen this year, and his first outing was very bad. He gave up four runs. I think it was a grand slam, three walks, just not good. Since then, though, he's really figured it out, it seems. In 6 2/3 innings over five appearances, he's given up one hit, four walks, and he struck out 12. And it's just encouraging to see that he's starting to figure that out in that bullpen role. The stuff I know he went through some pitching development this year, kind of changed around how he was. He did some like pitch, you know, that advanced pitch training stuff they do.
Pitch editing.
One of those facilities. He did that.
Pitch design.
Thank you. He did that this offseason, and the stuff's been pretty good. You know, the fastball's in the mid-90s. And so, yeah, he's just an interesting guy to watch and someone I'm constantly monitoring of those kind of group of interesting Greenville relievers.
Yep. The guy I want to pick is this week's player of the week at Sox Prospects, and that's outfielder Tyler Dearden. The first rule of Tyler Dearden is if he plays well, you have to talk about him, and that's what we're going to do here. So on the season, he's hitting .326, .466, .761. That's his slugging is .761. He's got five home runs. And just to be clear, that's his career high in home runs already. His previous career high was four, set in Lowell in 2018 in 47 games. He also did it again last year in 60 games in Greenville when Greenville was low A. Now with Greenville as high A affiliate, he's already got five to go with five doubles. He was a guy always who part of his problem was just staying on the field. I remember he had a
yeah, he had a lot of like back injuries.
Significant back injury a couple of years back, I want to say.
Yeah, it was back injury.
If only there were a place. Yeah, are you looking at his profile?
I am.
Okay, yeah. I mean, he was, you know, he really has had a problem staying on the field. And last year, I think it was partially staying on the field, and partially it was just that he wasn't the starter. But he was really hot last week in five games. He had hits in all of them. He's got a six-game hitting streak. He had three home runs last week. And for the week, why he was named the player of the week, he hit, there we go, .450, .522, .1050. Three doubles, three bombs in five games. Heck of a week. And it's just interesting to see him coming around at the plate, staying healthy. You know, he was a guy who did get a bonus. Did he get 125, Ian, if you're still on his page? Or 175?
No, he got 140.
140. Okay, so he got over slot.
Yeah.
Because he was a 17th round pick? This is off the top of my head.
No, he's 20th. Like a 21st or 29th. 29th.
Like 17, 29. They look the same. So it's been very interesting to see him staying healthy, being the starting left fielder in Greenville. Not the youngest player anymore, but certainly not so old that you would ignore him. It'll be interesting to see if he can keep this up. And, you know, if he's still doing it a mid-year, what they do. Does he stay there? Does he move up to Portland? The other thing with him is defense. He's never been a stud defender. I remember seeing him in Hagerstown in 2019. So it wasn't great in the outfield, and he was left field only pretty much. I think this year he's played a little bit of right field. But, yeah, I mean, Dearden's a guy who's hitting really well so far, off to a very good start.
Well, and I think Dearden, like the things I'm watching is his walk rate is 19%. His career high before that, taking out like rookie ball, is like 6-7%. I don't know how sustainable that is. That's interesting. K rate still 33%, which is a lot of swing and miss in his game. That's kind of always been the issue. And the BABIP is obscenely high, so it's going to come down.
But he's also tearing the cover off the ball. I mean,
yeah,
doubles.
I mean,
and
the
home
results
runs
speak for themselves. Like he's got five bombs. He's hitting the ball very hard and very far. So, you know, it's definitely interesting and something that's going to be, I think, bear watching because he's someone I've always liked. Like, he's got a really, really – his swing is interesting. It's kind of like a Cody Bellinger-esque swing where he torques it up and then just rips through the zone. He's got that tall, athletic frame you look for. So he's an interesting guy. And, yeah, I'm interested to kind of follow and get some more feedback on him as the season goes on.
Yeah, moving up to Portland, I'm going to go next, and I'm going to highlight – you know, last time we highlighted Johan Mieses, who, like we mentioned, is old for the level. You know, really have to take his results so far with a grain of salt. We're going to get an even bigger grain of salt this week to highlight Joey Meneses, who he's been – it's kind of funny. I always think of him and Mieses together, both because they're both JM names. They were signed close in time to each other. They re-signed as free agents, minor league free agents this past offseason. And they're both in Portland. A little old for the level. Meneses, he's at an age 29 year. But on the year, he's hitting .302, .343, .587. I think we mentioned in the Mexican League, his name is Caballoy. So it's like Caballo is a horse, so it's Caballoy Meneses. I kind of liked the nickname. Hitting the ball really well this year. He's splitting, not splitting time with Mieses, but they're like alternating DH and right field. So one will DH for four games, the other will DH for four games, while the other one's playing in right. It's kind of interesting because he's played all over the diamond. Meneses, he's played during the Mexican League this winter. He played mostly third base, which he kind of never had before, which made me think the Red Sox were having him do that. Given that Roldani Baldwin is playing a lot of third base, I'm almost a little surprised that Meneses isn't getting any time there, but at any stretch, yeah, I mean, he's having a pretty good year. That said, this is more or less just to point out a little old for the level, huge grain of salt. I need to see him doing it in AAA, and even then, I mean, this is almost like a Roberto Pettigini or a Sandy Madeira type situation where I'm going to need to see it in the major leagues before I care, I think. But a good start, and he's doing what he's supposed to do. Ian, who do you got, unless you've got anything on Meneses?
No, not really anything to add there. I was going to bring up one of the favorites, I think, Pedro Castellanos, who just one of the most unique prospects I think we've had in the site's history, just with how just how weird his profile is. I don't know a better way to put it.
It's weird.
One sec. I got to bring up his page.
It's weird.
I had it, and then I accidentally closed it, and now my computer's not working. There we go. And I think just the biggest thing we've kind of talked about with him is hitting for power. And he's off to – I mean, he's got two home runs, which – if you looked at his first half last year, there's a drastic improvement on that. But I think that the thing kind of with me is his K rate has always been really low. And this year it's actually up to 23%. I do wonder if that's a byproduct of him trying to hit for more power.
Yeah.
The walk rate is up though too. So he's being a little more passive at the plate. I haven't seen him live, so I want to get out there and get a look at him pretty soon. But, you know, he's off to a solid start, like 266, 342 OBP. Slug's only 375.
Yeah.
But yeah, he's just someone that, you know, he had a decent week. I think he hit close to 300 for the week. He's transitioning into the outfield and
has played only outfield so far, by the way.
Yeah. And I think the thing though, that is just the batted ball profile changes is his ground ball rate. The last 2 years has been around 50%. And then this year it's down at 28%. Now it could be small sample size stuff, but his fly ball rate has greatly increased. And I do wonder if that's just about as kind of what happens when he's trying to hit for more power. Mm-hmm. So we shall see. Just some interesting, you know, under the radar, you know, analytical changes there that kind of lend itself to a more power profile that he seems to be going for.
Yep. Yeah, he's interesting this year. Who do you got? I almost did it myself. Worcester.
Worcester, I think we should talk about Jeter Downs, because obviously Downs got off to a slow start, and I think people kind of were – it was all – and he got kind of caught up in the hype with Jaren Duran that he was kind of like looked past. They moved him down in the order a little bit after a few bad games, but quietly over his last 14 games, so if you take out the first three games of the season, he's hitting 321 with a 400 OBP and a 528 slug. As a guy who played 12 games in AA and is only, what, 22 years old?
Yeah.
Like, that's pretty interesting. He's got, you know, two home runs in his last three games, seven steals, which is, you know, obviously for someone who we know his instincts are good. But he's not the fastest guy, so it's interesting to see he's running a lot. And the strikeouts are definitely too high, and I do think they will come down eventually. But it's just good to see him at least holding his own in AAA. And I think it, as we kind of talked about earlier, that I'm interested to see how he handles himself at the Olympics qualifying thing. Mm-hmm. And then
where he's probably going to be one of the best players.
Yeah. Then it just more of does he come back? And if this continues, is he someone we start hearing about some potential, you know, noise for maybe he has a chance to make his debut at some point this year?
Yeah, I think that makes sense. I could see it. Especially just give, I mean, but the problem is just the depth they have in the infield,
which we didn't think. We thought second base was kind of a black hole coming into the year, but now it's like, oh wait, they have a bunch of interesting guys to play there.
Well, they've got, I mean, on the roster right now, you've got, once Arroyo is going to get activated, you've got Kike Hernandez, Danny Santana, who am I forgetting? Marwin Gonzalez.
And Marwin Gonzalez has not hit at all. I mean, I think he's the one,
but he's been their best defensive player by a pretty significant
and that's the
trade-off. Amount.
That is the trade-off, because, I mean, Santana's – you can't take anything. He's got two home runs in two games, but who knows. But, like, Hernandez has really come around the plate. His OBP's well over 300 now. He seems pretty entrenched as kind of the leadoff hitter. So Arroyo, though, is hitting, you know, 275. Like, Marwin Gonzalez is not hitting, but as you said, he's so versatile and defensive player that it's tough to find playing time. But, you know, who knows? Maybe something happens where it puts him in a position where they need a potential bat like him.
Yeah, it'll be, I could see that conversation start to happen, but again, I mean, and he's not on the 40 man either though.
But the thing is, at least at the end of the year, both him and Durant have to be at it anyway after the season. So, you know,
when you get to
September, that's when you, or, you know, August, September, if they're both playing really well, you kind of figure that stuff
out. Yeah, definitely. Definitely. So, yeah, my guy that I want to highlight is Kyle Hart. Of course, we all remember his major league debut last year, which went, let's be frank here, horribly. Just to remind everyone, unfortunately, sorry, 24 hits, 21 runs, 19 of them earned in 11 innings, an ERA of 15.55 with a 3.091 whip, struck out 13 batters still somehow in those 11 innings, but he also just faced so many hits, 67 hitters in those 11 innings, so he was averaging six hitters an inning. Wasn't good. We find out later that he had Lyme disease during the break between spring training and the alt site, but then he went to the alt site and pitched well. People forget the two starts at the alt site before he got called up. He had a perfect game and a near perfect game. So, you know, he was dealing down there and he came up and it just wasn't worked. And we mentioned he just has such a slim margin for error that he can't miss his spot. He needs to have pretty much pinpoint perfect command. So far this year, in three starts, he's had great success, particularly in his last two starts. This is his second week where he was a consideration for Pitcher of the Week, and he might be our Pitcher of the Week this week. His start against Buffalo on the 20th, he went seven innings, allowed one run on three hits, three walks, six strikeouts. His previous start, he went six no-hit innings against Syracuse. He did have four walks and a hit by pitch, but he also struck out six. Through 103 pitches in those six innings, through 95 pitches in the seven innings in his most recent start. And it's just good to see him get back on the horse is the thing that stood out to me. I'm just glad to see a guy like that not just completely lose his confidence. His first start wasn't great. 3 2/3, seven hits, four runs, did have six strikeouts to one walk. Not everything is strikeout to walk ratio, though. You know, the four runs, he gave up a home run that game, gave up a home run for the one run in this game. Like I said, his mistake pitches are going to get hit. He just needs to minimize the number of mistake pitches and not have anyone be on base. He's allowed eight walks on the year. He needs to tune up that command and that control a little bit. But it's good to see him get it back together. Do you want to go straight to emails, Mr. Ian?
Yes, let's do it.
Let's do some emails. All right. As I mentioned, every episode we want to talk about what you want to hear about, so hit us up at podcast@soxprospects.com. That's the email for the site. All right, our first email comes to us from Brian in Nevada. He says, "Hi, guys. Quick question that just occurred to me. The consensus seems to be that there are four top draft prospects this year with a drop-off from there, and I want to note he only sent this 6 days ago. He said, the Red Sox pick fourth, and they seem to be in line to pick California prep shortstop Marcelo Mayer, which would suit me just fine. Where would young Marcelo rank on the SoxProspects.com list right now? Bonus question, if Vanderbilt righty Kumar Rocker somehow falls to them, where would he rank on your list? Double bonus question, if you're the Tigers, do you have the stones to sign a couple underslots and pass on Rocker, who might have 1 or 2 years left of eligibility by the time they're done rebuilding? Or do you take a page from the Rays playbook and draft Rocker, then trade him for a bunch of other prospects in a few years? Thanks, as always, for reading and commenting. Great days ahead, Brian in Nevada." Yeah, first of all, this was true about 2 weeks ago, Ian.
Yeah, there's 0% chance it seems Marcelo Mayer is going to be there at four.
Right
now,
right.
It seems like he's the favorite to go 1-1, if anything.
I wouldn't say he's the favorite, but he doesn't get out of the top three, is what Baseball America. Carlos Collazo did their most.
I mean, he's been
mock.
Going 1-1 in almost every mock I've seen so far the last couple of weeks, the last week or so. Yeah, he's got serious helium right now, and I just don't really think there's – I mean, in the BA mock today, he went first. I just don't really think it's likely he gets 2-4 anymore. It seems like Jordan Lawler's kind of in the same camp, who he's been mocked at 2 in a lot of things. So
BA mock today, I think it had Lawler 1, but it was like Lawler goes in the top 2 and Mayer doesn't get out of the top 3. The mock that BA posted today had Brady House going 4, and then the Red Sox take Jack Leiter – Brady House going 3.
Yeah,
the Red Sox take Jack Leiter 4 with Henry Davis and Kumar Rocker both still on the board.
Yeah, I mean, if I was having this discussion with someone this week about how I would rank my kind of order of preference based on everything I'm reading, and I've gotten way more into the draft this year than past years. A lot of it due to the Red Sox having a high pick. It's a lot easier to kind of like
there's only so many guys.
Map it out.
Yeah,
exactly. And I think Mayer would be far and away my top choice if he was available. And
Mayer or Lawler, but Lawler's strikeout
no,
issues
I
worry
think I'd
me.
rather have Mayer,
Yeah.
and I don't have Lawler too. I think Henry Davis is my number two. I'm really in on Henry Davis. I'm very impressed with what I see. I mean, the reports seem really good coming out of what he's done this year. And I don't draft for need, but having a stud catching prospect wouldn't be the worst thing if you're the Red Sox. Like, it would really fit what the organization needs really well. So
Right.
he's someone that's pretty interesting to me. I would have Lawler three, and then four would probably be lighter. But I think if any of those top four, and frankly, I think they're going to have a choice. I mean, they're obviously going to have their choice of two of the top five guys.
Yeah.
Two of that group plus Rocker are going to be there. But yeah, I don't Rocker, if they took him, I'm not as in on Rocker as I should be probably. His profile just scares me. Like the
It's
constant
weird.
velocity, the fact that his velocity comes and goes like it does, his body type is just high maintenance. And I just think pitchers inherently, like we're kind of seeing it with the Red Sox this season, pitchers get hurt. And
Yeah.
if I'm picking fourth, I'd much rather take a hitting prospect in the top four and grab a pitcher later. Because as we've seen again this year, like you can find pitching in later rounds that turns into high-end guys. Like Brandon Woodruff is pitching for the Brewers right now. And obviously he's been one of the best pitchers in baseball this year, and for the last 3 years he was an 11th round pick out of college. Like you can find
Bieber.
and obviously he's a unicorn in that regard. Like he's you're not gonna you're obviously the odds of you finding guys that good are really low, but you can even find usable guys later on in the draft. And I just think that with that early second round pick, I'd much rather if I had my choices, take a hitter in the first round and then get a pitcher in the second round. Hope, maybe Jaden Hill or Gunnar Hoglund, one of the TJ guys, falls. Like
Yeah.
there's a lot I like that outcome a lot more than taking Leiter and having to pay or Rocker and having to pay. Let's be honest, they're gonna want full slot at least for that pick, if not above it. I'd rather go with the hitter there than pay full freight for a pitcher and not have any, and then have to get a hitter in the second round where I just think there's more of a drop off there.
Yeah, I have a really hard time taking either of the Vanderbilt pitchers over Davis. It's just, I don't know. And it's kind of funny because if with everything I read, the top high school arm, Jackson Jobe,
Yeah, he's super interesting,
he
but
is
it's
probably
scary.
the best pitcher available based on what
But
I've seen, but he's a high school pitcher.
that profile is terrifying. And we've kind of seen in the last 2 years, I don't think a prep pitcher's gone in the top 15 either of the
Nope.
last 2 years, or top 10. It's one of those
Nope.
two. But it
No,
was
it's 15.
Mick Abel was like 16 last year, and the
And
year
then
before, I
Quinn
believe it was
Priester.
Quinn Priester was like 18.
Yep,
So
exactly.
it seems that the industry as a whole is kind of having a course correction when it comes to prep arms.
Well, it is and
And
it isn't, because part of it is also just what's available at the top of the draft, right? Because like this year, I mean, look, like what's strong this year? It's like high school hitters. It's a bad college hitter class.
yeah, other than Davis, it's like Sal Frelick, and it's like I think Sal Frelick's interesting. Like I've
Yeah.
watched a lot of his games because he's
Matt
local.
McClain's ha been better in the second half, is my
But
understanding,
like
out
Sal
of
Frelick, even
UCLA.
McClain, like Sal Frelick's like 5'9".
Yeah.
Like
So,
it's like a five
well,
nine
it's
outfielder.
and before everyone starts screaming Pedroia, Mookie Betts, like it's he's not like those two guys had like uncanny hand eye,
Yeah.
and Betts is a preternatural athlete. Like
Yeah.
it's different. Some of these guys, like the profile on a Frelick, it's like yeah, I don't know.
Yeah.
I don't want Frelick at four.
And kind of with regards to it's obviously going to depend on who they take, but with Rocker, like I would not have him in my top. He'd maybe be three. He'd be three or
Well,
four.
so this is the question we keep getting, is where's the number four pick going to rank? And on the forum, there was a discussion about it, and like people were assuming the number four pick's going to be the number one prospect.
There's a 0% chance of anyone they
No
take it.
chance.
I mean,
None.
we were talking about this before. I think we'll talk about it probably more as the month wraps up. But one of the biggest takeaways from the season so far is that Tristan Casas is the top prospect in the system, and it's not really that close.
No,
Like
I've been saying it for 2 years.
he is just an it, it,
I don't
he's
care that he
just
plays first base. I
yeah.
really
It doesn't
don't.
matter. He's gonna hit for a ton of power. Like, and
Did you s go
it might
ahead.
be sooner than we think. Like his home run, it was that what you're about to say?
No, I was gonna say something else, but go
His
ahead.
home run he hit yesterday, if you haven't seen the video, go look it up. I think like Red Sox Stats had it on Twitter.
Brought to you by Chico's Bail Bonds.
That ball, I don't know if it's landed yet. Like he just absolutely is destroying baseball. I mean, he's hitting 328, 400, 552 in double A as a 21-year-old.
The right fielder didn't even move, right? I love those.
Yeah, no, and the ball, if you've been in New Hampshire, it cleared like the driveway out in right field. So basically how New Hampshire set up is there's a fence, there's like a gap, like some grass and stuff. And then there's the, then there's the parking lot, like the way out of the parking lot. And he was way out of like past that. And that's probably like 30 feet behind the fence. Like, yeah, it was a bomb. So I would say he'll be clear whoever they draft. Just whoever they draft to wrap this up will probably be in discussion. I would say like the 2 to 4 range, probably 3 to 4 for me.
Probably 3 to 4. Cause it's like, I mean, it depends who's there, right? Because it's like 2 and 3 will be Duran and Downs in some order. I think Downs is going to stay number 2 on June 1st, most likely. I can't imagine Duran passes him. I don't think it's going to.
Downs is just as good almost. Like,
but I could see Duran by mid-July being like a set number 3 where the new guy comes in and is 4. I could see it. I can't imagine. So next up would be Jimenez.
I don't think there's any way they're below 4.
No,
I think
they're probably 3 or 4. Or maybe 2 if Downs and Duran are both struggling between now and then. But yeah, I can't imagine.
Well, but even if they're struggling, like it would have to be, I'm not going to react to the statistics. It would have to be,
I'm not saying the statistics, but I mean like struggling. I'm not saying like their batting average is below 300. Like I'm saying, you know, they're in AAA and not playing great. Like that's a thing that happens, you know, you start pressing. So yeah, I think it's 2 to 4 is where the number 4 pick is going to go. And it depends who it is. And it depends, you know, do they cut a deal with a guy to get a, you know, a top guy at 40, you know, when they think that, I don't know. We'll have to see. We'll talk more about the draft in coming weeks as well. Thanks for the question, Brian. Our next email, if I can get it to load, comes from Michael. And he says, hi, Chris and Ian. I'm curious for your thoughts on Jordan DiValerio. I was at the May 18th Salem at Fredericksburg game. I was very impressed. Seemed like he was able to get a lot of swings and misses on his curveball. I know you project him as an organizational depth arm. Any revisions to that after a strong start to the year? Also wondering if you happen to know the longest winless streak to begin the season of a new / relocated minor league team, Fred Nats or 0-13. Thanks as always, Michael. We talked about DiValerio, but I wanted to make sure we read Michael's great email. So thank you for the email, Michael. Our next question comes from Al Mendel. It's another guy that we've already talked about. Chris and Ian, really enjoyed your bonus reports from Worcester's home opener. I hope I can get out there for a game someday. Question, Kyle Hart really struggled in the majors and limited action in 2020, but I wonder how much of that had to do with his injury last year. He's been extremely good in the minors, including strong AAA numbers in 2019 and again in 2021. Is Hart good enough to be a major league back of the rotation starter whose 2020 performance was impacted by an injury, or is he a AAA starter whose stuff is simply not good enough to play at the major league level? Thank you, Al Mendel. Ian, I think it's somewhere in between the two.
Yeah, I think he's like an emergency up and down guy.
Could maybe be a long reliever in a perfect world like if you needed him to be that for a short period. I think it's somewhere between there. I don't think he's just a AAA guy. I don't think he's a surefire back of the rotation guy either. But thanks for the email and for the question. And that's all for this week. Again, it's podcast@soxprospects.com. We want to talk about what you want to hear about. Send in your questions. Ian, I think that's about it. Let's hit the road. Thank you all for listening. As I alluded to, we're going to try and keep this Monday night thing going. We'll see if we can keep it going forward. So keep your earballs open going forward for that freshness on Tuesdays or probably Wednesdays is when these will drop. We'll record them on Monday night. Give Joe Tuesday to record, probably drop them on Wednesday. So for Ian, I'm Chris. We want to give a thanks to Podcast Joe 2.0 for editing, producing, mixing, etc. the podcast. Make sure you follow us on Twitter at Sox Prospects is the site account. You can follow at Sox Prospects on Instagram as well. Follow Ian on Twitter at Ian Cundall. That's IANCUNDALL. Follow me at SP Chris Hatfield on Twitter. We want to thank the Ludlow Thieves for our music, our intro and outro music, All the Money. Find them on Spotify, Tidal, Amazon Music. I don't know. Is Tout still a thing? I don't know. Whatever they're on. Maybe they have
Apple Music.
TikTok. I don't know. I'm sure they've got dances on TikTok. Who knows? At any rate, check them out. I think that's about it. For Ian, I'm Chris. Thank you all for listening. We'll be back at you soon.